Hello, and welcome to the Fireside Chat with UPC Insurance on leading digital transformation. In this session, we're going to talk about how UPC is leading the way with its digital transformation. We're going to touch upon some of the key aspects of UPC's transformation journey, from adopting agile model, engaging the business, enabling cultural change, building the right technical and operational capabilities, creating compelling customer experience, to governing the transformation. We at Mindtree are proud to partner with UPC and Duck Creek on this journey. I'm your moderator, Sanjay Kanungo. I head Mindtree's Insurance Package Solutions Group. I have about 30 years of experience in the IT industry, and it has been my passion for the last 17 years to help insurers successfully transform their business using modern technologies. And it is my honor today to talk to Chris Griffith, CIO of UPC Insurance, whom I have known for a couple of years now. Hey there, Chris. He is a big picture thinker and an unconventional leader, and it is always inspiring to hear from leaders like Chris and learn from them about how they are driving their organization's transformation into becoming leading digital insurer. Chris has over 14 years of experience in the insurance industry and over 20 years of technology-related experience. Prior to UPC, Chris served as a CIO of Safety National, a specialty insurance carrier part of the Tokio Marine Group. He has a strong background in both data and digital innovation and has implemented many large-scale transformation projects. Chris is also an avid tennis player, as you can see from the wall behind him and the bobblehead. And anytime you are in St. Pete or Tampa area, feel free to reach out and challenge him to a match. Chris, welcome to the program, and thank you for joining.
Thanks, Sanjay, my friend. It's good to be here. And like you said, anytime you want a challenge, just let me know.
That's awesome. So talking about St. Pete, Florida, where UPC is based, UPC is one of the fastest growing regional insurance carriers in the U.S., and one of the top 20 writers of homeowners insurance and related lines. So tell us what makes UPC unique.
Well, that's a good question. And it's something we're proud of. The fact that we have grown so quickly in the homeowner space and commercial lines. We have quite a commercial book as well. What makes us unique? I mean, you can kind of see it on the shirt here, right? Bold is one of our mottos. Our 2020 action plan, actually, from our CEO was be bold in 2020. We didn't quite anticipate how bold we had to be with coronavirus and all that changed in the world this year. But we took that as our motto and we ran with it. We're really focused right now on what makes us great and where we have our real strengths, which is coastal business. You know, we're here to protect anybody that's in a major storm. We're a CAT writer. Our goal is to be the premier catastrophe writer in the country, personal and commercial. And you know what that means is, for our insureds, it's at the worst point of their life. They're in the middle of a hurricane, typically. House is potentially destroyed, and we're one of the first people they call. And we're here to help them get them back on their feet and get their house rebuilt and just take care of our customers. So it's a privilege to work here, and it's a privilege to share in a mission to really help people at their biggest time of need in life.
And what I really love about your motto is keeping the promise to the agents and policyholders at the time of their greatest needs, like you said. But also building that, those foundational principles of superior claim service, ease of doing business, like customer experience, that's built into your foundational principles, which must provide a great platform or foundation, if you will, to take on your digital transformation journey. And so can you talk about your transformation journey so far? And the benefits you have realized, I think it's incredible.
Sure. So I think you said it well. You know, we have our five foundations as a company. We also have two core values as employees that really stick out. You know, we have the traditional core values like teamwork and relationships and the things that most companies have, but we have two that in particular really lead us to digital innovation, and that's bias to action and persistence. Bias to action is the value that we can be bold and we can make decisions and we can take charge and not be afraid of consequences of those actions. But persistence means that when the decision we made maybe doesn't go the right way, that we have what it takes to stick through it and correct the error and get us back on the right path. Those two qualities are kind of baked into everyone we hire and really leads to a partnership with business on innovation where they're bringing ideas to us, but they're also willing to listen when IT has an idea for how we can improve things. And we can truly have a partnership with business to innovate and take our company to the next level. It's refreshing to work for a company where everyone on the executive team really believes we're as much a technology company as we are an insurance company. And when you think about the world today, and where digital innovation really is at the core of most companies that are at the top, the successful companies, to have an executive team that's really buying into that and pushing an agenda of digital first thinking is really fun.
That's awesome. Those two qualities are built into your DNA of the company. That's amazing, which is so important to realize the digital transformation needed and be successful in that approach. So I know that since you started this journey, you have accomplished a ton of things from personal lines claims going live to commercial lines claims getting integrated, policy billing being rolled out. So and all in a very short period of time, and I would think ahead of schedule. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So when I first joined, we were starting our journey, and I use that word a little tongue in cheek because we have a company. One of our companies in the UPC umbrella is Journey Insurance. We started the journey to implement a core system that was a single system, one system to go to, one vendor to work with, one partner in Mindtree to help us implement and really go with a model that I've had successful in my career of finding a partner to stick with, but also having ownership ourselves in the process. And so some of the things that we're able to do with that process is, like you said, is you know, stay on track and put in Duck Creek claims. And right behind that, put in our roll out our first state with Journey for policy. And now we're on a path for, you know, policy billing and data insights now rolled out for all of our states where we do business and all of our companies that we write in. And it's really exciting to have the vision for the future when we are on that single platform and we do have, you know, the single partner with you and we have our own employees that have a lot of strength in the Duck Creek platform to be able to innovate from there, stay current with Duck Creek, continue to take their new features as innovation for us as well, but also to be able to build our own innovative tools and our own innovative services with our MuleSoft ESB and some of the things that we can do with headless integration with Duck Creek. And there are a lot of advantages we have now that we're looking towards a future of single system of one source of truth and one skill set to maintain within the IT department.
That's great. Now, so from the beginning, I realized that you were very clear about one thing, and that is adopting agile model of implementation. So please tell us why the traditional approaches of running large programs don't work and why you think agile is the right approach to follow.
Sure. I'll couch that by saying don't work well for me, because I think some companies probably have had success with traditional model of a fixed bid project with one SI, and you kind of hand the project to that SI and you look over there every once in a while and you let them run it. My history with that was those projects typically go long. They typically cost more money than they said they would when we start. There's typically a lot of scope change in the end because business didn't quite know what they needed when you started. And so you have a lot of scope change that happens throughout the project. And so it leads to, I would say, more of a bad taste in the mouth of business and the executive teams of those companies when they say, why are we spending so much money to implement this system? To me, I wanted to rethink that and invent a way that would give us more visibility, more ability to pivot as needed. And so you use the word agile. I would say none of us can run pure agile in insurance. I think it's rare. Maybe if you're running truly digital only innovation projects that, you know, are POCs, yes, you can run agile. But when you're talking about a big transformational implementation where you're replacing essentially the kidneys, the heart, and the lungs of your company at the same time, you have to have some visibility on the front side of what you're trying to build. How much is it going to cost? How long is it going to take? And those are kind of counterculture to agile. So I would say what we do is more what I would call wagile or iterative development, where you have some heavy requirements up front to get you to a point where you can understand what you're trying to build and how it deviates from the base system that you're implementing. You have definitely stage gates along the way to help you gauge how you're doing from the cost of the system and the timeline. And you have routine reports that go to executives and the board on the progress of your project. All of those things kind of run counterculture to agile, which is where the W in Wagile comes from, the waterfall-ish part of agile. But inside of those development cycles with QA and dev, you're running very iteratively, right? You have sprints, you have deliverables at the end where you're able to do retrospectives and you're able to plan the next sprint based on what business sees in the current sprint. All of that is good. But there's also a piece that's really important to the success of a project that's running that way, the iterative style, and that is what I would like to, what I refer to as two in the box. And that is where UPC employees learn from Mindtree and Duck Creek and whoever the SI is and whoever the vendor is. It doesn't have to just apply to this case. And over time throughout the project, take over in the key leadership roles. And I like to try to do it somewhere about halfway through the first implementation. Sometimes it takes a little longer than that. But if you can truly make the ownership of the management and the leadership of that project, and even some of the development positions and some of the QA positions and some of the technical positions as well, be actual employees of UPC, then you have way more buy-in and ownership and accountability to the success of the project. And that's how you get to what you were referring to as on time or ahead of time and on budget, is you become the owner of that and you become more in control of your destiny throughout the project. And then you can truly have what you said earlier, which I liked the word that you used, a partnership, because I truly feel like we're partners with both Duck Creek and Mindtree. It's not a vendor relationship, it's a true partnership. And we can come to you when we need staff augmentation and we want, more people spun up for a particular project. We can go to Mindtree, our partner, and say, hey, we need some people to help us with this, but we're not looking for a fixed bid on it. We're looking for you to come in and augment our staff and really supplement our team and provide expertise. I know that was a long answer, but
That's great. That's great. I thank you very much. So I like that partnership philosophy that we have. But just with respect to this development, this one thing I was really impressed by that you brought. The team actually implemented it, which is called the daily build, which is a great mechanism for instantaneous feedback, continuous business involvement, and mostly, most importantly, close collaboration with the business, right? So they're not waiting until the sprint is done, a particular phase is done. They're actually part of the daily calls where they're seeing what's being developed, giving their feedbacks, and the development team is not chasing doing things that are not important to business and just focusing on those things that are critical to them. And also not realizing it at the end of it and having to do a lot of rework.
Right.
I thought that was just phenomenal. And also the to learn that, hey, there might be a different way to do this. And having that two-way communication almost on a daily basis, I thought was worked great. What's your view on that?
Absolutely. You know, it's one of the core tenets of the agile piece of Wagile that we brought in was that idea that the owner of the project is business, it's not IT.
Right.
They're at the table every day. They're in the stand-ups. They're listening to, you know, the plight of the developer. They're hearing what's happening, but they're also seeing the daily build. And they're giving us that feedback when they see a screen and they say, that's not what we wanted at all. That's not happening to us 3 months down the road. That's happening to us live as we're building it. And developers in QA are listening to that, and they're able then to go and adapt the screen, sometimes almost real time, to especially with Duck Creek, when it's so easy to go configure the manuscript, they were able in many cases to turn that feedback from business around the next day. And the next build the business saw had already changed the things that they said the day before wasn't what they wanted. And I think that really instilled confidence in business, and they saw that, okay, this is actually going to work. And so it was incremental, but it did build the confidence of the team.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So let me switch topic just a little bit and talk about your claim service. It's we talked about how it's one of your founding principles, and you have made huge improvements in this customer experience area. Especially related to claims processing and FNOL reporting, and claims intake that used to take hours now just happens in a few minutes. So can you talk about how you are continuously improving that customer experience aspect?
Sure, and it starts with continuing the process. So we've been live now on the claim system since July of last year. Interestingly, we went live in New York. We wanted to test one state for a month. And as I said before, we're a CAD carrier. And the day before we went live, for the first time in over a decade in New York, there were 3 tornadoes. So we were expecting like maybe 5 claims the first day. And we had something like 150 claims come in the first day of our system launch. And so for us in a single state to have 150 claims was a big deal. We were able to, the system handled it and managed it well. So it was really good to see that. So now that we've been on the system for a year and we're converting claims in, what we're realizing is that connection, the integration that we have, like you said, to our FNOL vendor, the integration we were able to build to our electronics payments vendor so that when a CAT happens and someone's displaced from their home and they can't get back home, and they have no money, they have no access to their bank account, let's say they don't even have anything on them, we're able to wire them a card that has $5,000 on it directly to them and say, here you go. And we can do it with the push of a button in the claim system. Whereas before, there was no way for us to even do that. We'd have to mail them a check, right? We're able to really increase our customer service ability by having Duck Creek in place. And it's with the integrations that we were able to do with the system, not even just the base platform. The base system itself brought its own ease of use and its own streamlining of some of our processes, where we were able to really bring some cost savings to the claims department by shifting resources to other areas as we completely freed up certain departments from work that they were having to manually key, again, through integrations.
Yeah, that's really impressive. And I also wanted to comment that part of ensuring that customer experience not being negatively impacted during this kind of CAT event is really being prepared for it and properly stress testing it.
Yep.
And I know you're telling me how we did a stress test for 1,000 claims per hour.
Yeah, we built what's called the hurricane button, which is basically your team helped us do it. We built a full performance test as if we were under the worst than the worst possible scenario for us with the number of policies we have, and we tested out for the worst possible Cat 5 that could hit and a concentration along some of our core business routes. And then we multiplied that by two and said, let's test the claim system against that number of claims coming in. And it performed, which was, you know, the first couple of times it didn't. It helped us find some problems, which was great. And we were able to go make some code and some config changes and some changes to some server settings at DCOD and Duck Creek On Demand. And we were able to tune it to where it would handle a load of 1,000 claims an hour, which is pretty, it would be a bad day for us, but at the same time, it would be, you know, reassuring to know that the system could handle it.
That's amazing. Yeah. So talk a little bit about how you are able to adapt to the changing markets and evolving needs using your system.
Sure. So, I mean, a good example of that, we went live with Journey Taxes in our policy system, and, you know, business about 2 days in said, hey, we need to make a change. You know, the state's asking us to adapt some of our forms and change a couple of our rules. And in the past, you know, that would have taken a while with our legacy systems, and there would have been cycles to it. And we were able to get in and get into the manuscripts and get into a quick cycle and turn that request around in a couple of days, and really show the true power of not only day one of launching the system, but also day two and how quickly we can adapt. We're also right now proving out the inheritance model of the policy system and how we can build a base, you know, a base UPC product with a state with all of our products in it, and be able to take that and inherit it to a second state. It's going really well. You know, we've actually had a couple of inheritance parties, virtual parties, because we're, you know, respecting COVID. But we've had a couple of virtual parties just celebrating the fact that it is so easy to be able to take that base product and inherit it out and see it working and then just change it from there. So it's, you know, really refreshing to me to be able to say that that's going well, and that my teams are excited by it, and so is business, that we can kind of prove out the technology that we invested in.
Yeah, and just being able to rapidly execute those improvements, you know, that's the key to that digital transformation, that you're able to do that and respond to those market needs, whether it's, you know, underwriting rules change or rate changes, and like you said, form changes. So, looks like you're doing a great job with that.
It lets us take resources that before would have just been working on only that for a lot of time,
yeah,
and have them start working on some more forward-thinking strategic type initiatives. So it does not only benefit us to be able to respond to business that quickly as a company, but it also frees up those resources to work on the more strategic initiatives and gives us more bandwidth to invest in digital innovation.
That's right. So one other topic I wanted to cover with you is, you know, this large complex transformation program, like one you were doing, it obviously needs multiple partners. And each one specializes in its own area. And how do you keep them all aligned to your project? And how do you make sure they don't go back to their corners when there is a problem, or they're not pointing fingers at each other? Mm-hmm. So tell us about that, because that's a key element of succeeding in a program like this.
You're absolutely right, and I'm not going to pretend like it's perfect. I think there are times when it's natural for each partner to kind of get in their own corner and put on their boxing gloves. What helps with that, honestly, is the two in the box approach and having the leadership come from UPC employees. And so when one of our employees comes in and says, all right, we have a problem, let me get the right people on the phone. And it might be three different vendors. You're absolutely right. There might be somebody helping with the MuleSoft integration. There might be somebody helping with, you know, the manuscripting in Duck Creek, and there might be a DCOD person we need on the phone to help us with something on the server. to have a UPC person coordinating that and bringing those resources together, and also kind of keeping the playing referee, right? Keeping everybody from pointing fingers at everybody else, is really important. And sometimes that takes me getting involved. You know, as the CIO, there are times I still roll my sleeves up. One example is we were having a problem in production with our policy system, where Google released an update to Chrome that broke something in our policy system. And, you know, the team was troubleshooting it for a couple of hours and not getting to a solution. And I jumped on the call and just got in with the team and started searching myself and found a couple of things and brought a couple of other people in the call. And then we helped find the solution and DCOD put in a fix and we were good. But, you know, there are times in transformational projects when things just aren't quite, you know, people just aren't quite behaving like you're saying, you know, people have their boxing gloves on, that the CIO does just need to get involved and calm everyone down and play referee himself or herself.
That's right. And I remember an incident where, you know, a legacy partner where they understood the legacy system pretty well and they were doing analysis, but they needed to really understand how Duck Creek sort of works out of the box, the features and functions of it. And for them to do that job, it was important for us to train them on Duck Creek. And right. And once that happened, right, things started moving smoothly and there was no delays or anything. So I think sometimes the partner has to step up, even though that's not their responsibility, but to help, because it's all one team. And it's like in your case, it's team UPC everybody's working on.
Everyone's being bold.
Everyone is being bold. And I love that. I love that. So one other topic I wanted to cover is, you know, obviously you have all these partners, but you also need to achieve self-sufficiency, right? So there are some things that UPC handles themselves. So how do you, as the project gets implemented, how do you take over some of these tasks? And what are some of the things that you rely on your partners to continue to do?
Yeah, great. That's a really good question. You know, two in the box helps with that, where, you know, we're going to staff the positions that we feel are the really key positions to leadership, first and foremost. But the positions that are more technical or skill set focused, you know, there's not really a need. If I have available resources that want to learn that, then we're more than willing to send them to training, which we've done for a few people. Get them to become Duck Creek manuscript experts or to really learn the platform from a QA perspective or a BA perspective. But a lot of times I would prefer to have my partners help us staff those positions, so that they can provide already trained, knowledgeable Duck Creek resources that have been on multiple projects in the past and really know the platform and can bring a lot of that knowledge forward and can help us make sure we're configuring the system based on working knowledge of how it's worked at a company, not based on theoretical, right? Because a lot of what you learn through training is theoretical. But we like to know what really worked at your last companies that you implemented this with. So I think it blends both worlds perfectly when you can say you provide strong leadership at UPC, plus some key leaders from your partners that are involved. Obviously, you have to have that. But you have the expertise of the people that have done it at other companies multiple times, and you're not trying to compete. I'm not trying to compete against Mindtree or Duck Creek to go hire your people. Like, that to me puts us in a more adversarial relationship. I'm looking for you to help me staff, augment my staff, and provide key resources that know how to do Duck Creek implementations really well.
Right. And you talked about this this bias to action and persistence earlier, which is very, you know, ingrained in UPC's culture. So talk to us about how you prepare the entire organization for such a big change, right?
It's a little easier at UPC because we do recruit people that have more of a biased action mentality and more of a willingness to change. it's, I've been at carriers where the tenure's longer and people kind of get in their ways that they're used to doing things, and it's hard to convince business to change a process. And you do have to spend a lot of your time then. Again, I've been there. You have to spend a lot of your time as the CIO in that scenario, working with business to help them understand the reason for change and why, you know, how much we would save both time and money if we were to change the business process instead of trying to adapt the system to that change. It does take a lot of work in most companies. At UPC, it's a little easier. First of all, I'm on the executive team. So, you know, my peers are the other executives. It's a lot easier for me to go to them and say, here's what we really need to do. Here's why. And they'll get it. And then they'll pass that along to their teams. And then business accepts it. It's a little easier conversation that way. It's also easier because the type of employee we hire is one that's going to say, okay, well, let me think about this and figure out how I can change my process and not have to over configure or customize the system so that it becomes a maintenance nightmare down the road. Really important. It's a key point to make on any of these transformational projects. The CIO's one of our core jobs, one of our most important jobs, is exactly what you're asking about here. And that is keep as core to the base product as you can. Do not customize. Configure where you need to configure. Do not over configure and don't customize the system. Stay within the box. And get work with your business partners to change the processes in their departments to work with the way the software works, and don't try to customize it because your upgrade path would be an absolute nightmare.
Right. So you touched upon this earlier, so which is working remotely in this new norm. And so talk to us a little bit about that. What is your secrets to working remotely successfully and enabling that high performing team as well?
Okay. You know, I think IT has a little easier job than others in that, because most of us have experience now with working with remote teams, working remotely ourselves. You know, I did a 5.5 year stint from my house working for a company. Leading development for a TPA, and my teams were everywhere. My teams were in other countries and other cities, and so IT has experience at this. And I think what we were able to do at UPC in particular is, when I came in 2 years ago, was to look and say, okay, how are we positioned if a hurricane was to hit St. Pete? What would we do as a company? How would we respond? And so we were already in a situation where we potentially wouldn't be sitting in this building that I'm in right now, but nobody else is here, by the way. Everyone else is home.
Right.
We wouldn't be able to work here. So we needed the ability to send everyone somewhere else to work already, kind of as a cat carrier that's writing insurance in a catastrophe prone area. So we had a plan already for how we would do that. Everyone had laptops already. Our VPN tunnels were all already tested and working, and we tested those routinely with our employees. Take their laptops home, test your connectivity, so everyone knew that they could connect. So basically, when we decided to close the office in March, we decided it on a Tuesday. We sent everyone home with two monitors and a docking station and a keyboard and a mouse and said, go work from home. And that afternoon, everyone was back online, and we noticed a productivity increase. Not decrease. We noticed a productivity improvement for the first couple of months. I think it's stabilized now since then, but people went home and they were all in. They were like, okay, we've got to do this together. I do wonder now, though, if there's a little, Zoom tiredness. People are kind of getting tired of Zoom meetings. But it's, I think, gotten to the point now where it's become the normal way that most people are comfortable working right now, especially through COVID. I do look forward to the day that I get to be around people again, but I think it potentially will change, the way all companies work for the rest of time, potentially, at least for the midterm. We'll probably all have continued flexible and work from home type, schedules, which again is great for IT. It helps us with the recruitment, and we've all already been doing it anyway for the most part. And I think it's an opportunity to allow all of us, insurance companies in particular, to recruit the best talent from anywhere we want to recruit from now. We're not limited geographically.
That's right. And also what is important in this virtual world is we are creating replicating that physical world contact, but also having these virtual parties or these virtual happy hours that you talked about earlier for releases is very important. So people still want to feel that camaraderie of working together, not feeling alone.
Right. UPC is actually having a virtual talent show coming up soon. And so as a company, we're letting people kind of pick a virtual talent. You know, somebody's going to be playing the violin. Another person, I think, is singing a song. And like we're just trying to keep our employees connected. And we have an intranet that does a good job of that, where we've really tried every single day to put something new out there about some employee, some personal thing. You know, there's a great one out there right now about one of our employees' granddaughters who has a pet chicken. And the pet chicken like follows her everywhere and sleeps with her at night. It's really kind of a crazy story. But it's one of those things that it kind of reminds you, okay, yeah, we're all still people. And it's fun to keep up with different employees in the company that way.
That's right. Okay, so one other question. I think we touched upon this earlier, but it is about you have significantly upgraded your technical infrastructure and your technical capabilities. You have added some latest and greatest technology, and so how does this help you first of all being first to market, constantly innovate? And I think talk a little bit about your technology environment that you have built.
Sure. I mean, that's one of the reasons why we went with Duck Creek On Demand. Is we see that is the future. And while it might be painful at the start, because we are an early adopter in that, we know that the benefits are going to far outweigh the challenges we faced on the initial implementation. And it's one of the reasons why we'll stay current with Duck Creek. And we'll always have a project going that says, what are the things that we need to do to get to the next version, to have the next release that's coming out be tested and ready to go. And it's also one of the reasons why we put in MuleSoft. You know, our vision is a vision to have to be APIs everywhere and to have the ability for whether it be a comparative rater or whether it be a direct connection to an agency, whether it be our own headless intake, whatever we want to have, we'll have a back-end service bus that can essentially serve that, whether the calls be to Duck Creek or Salesforce or some internal database that we've built or some caching that we do in MuleSoft. It's really important for us to have the technology there that's just, but business doesn't have to worry about it. They don't have to ask the question, can we? The assumption should always be we can. It's just a matter of, okay, are we going to make that the priority or not? And I think that's the shift we made in business's mind, is the shift from, well, IT is going to be a constraint, to IT can do it if we put the priority and the funding and the business investment of time behind it. We know that IT is going to deliver on that particular project. And that to me, when you ask about how do you get the most organizational change, it's when you can flip that switch in your business partner's mind to where they know that if they come to you with something and say, this is a priority for us and we need it, that IT is going to say, okay, we can do that and we already have the technology base to do that. That's what we're putting in with Duck Creek and that's what we're putting in with MuleSoft.
Thanks. That's great. So we do have a few survey questions, but before I go there, is there anything, any question you have?
Yeah, why don't we talk a little bit about Mindtree? So you guys have been a great partner for us. You helped us put claims in on schedule, like we talked about. You helped us put policy in, now launched during COVID, which is insane to say that we launched Journey Texas during a pandemic, went live, and it's been great for us. The agents love it. They say it's fast, easy to quote, simple, intuitive, exactly the comments I was hoping to hear. What's next for you guys?
Yes, Chris, that's a really great question. So thank you for that. I'd be happy to answer that. So about Mindtree a little bit, as you know, Mindtree provides digital transformation and technology services to help clients outperform their competition. We are about 22,000 minds strong, serving about 300 clients globally. And our parent company, L&T, is a $20 billion engineering and construction giant. We're seeing a huge demand for our services in recent times as more and more companies are adopting digital in a big way. But also our Duck Creek partnership, as you know, we're strategically focused on Duck Creek, and we have one of the biggest Duck Creek practices in the world. And it is very important to our business. We are a platinum Duck Creek partner with broad and deep relationship with them. But what is unique about us is that we were the first delivery partner for Duck Creek, and our experience on the platform actually far exceeds anyone out there. And I believe we're the only partner providing automation-led upgrade services on the DCOD environment. And as more and more carriers choose Duck Creek, it's opening new opportunities for us to add value to our clients. But what's more important is our client relationship. You know, our partnership with clients like yourself are extremely important. So at Mindtree, we believe our clients are truly the experts in their business. And as they transform their business, our job and our goal is to be their digital transformation partner of choice to help them succeed in their journey. Of course, we learn a lot by working with clients and leaders like you, and continuously improve our approaches and offerings based on that. For example, you know, one of the learnings from this project that has gone into improving our methodology is to combine that Scrum and Kanban into a single delivery model. We talked about daily bills, also doing Scrum, you know, in a planned manner, both at the same time. So, and we have built some new accelerators to do those gap analysis with, you know, out of the box process flows and epics and feature lists and things like that. But our strategic focus in the Duck Creek space, we are actually focusing on four areas. And from an insurance industry perspective as well, which is cloud first approach, customer experience, data and cognitive, and enterprise IT transformation. So I know that was a long answer to your question, but I hope that that clarifies some things for you about what we are doing.
No, I can attest to everyone out there watching, you know, it wasn't just a sales pitch. Sanjay's right, they're doing all of that. They've helped us with quite a few of those areas already, and we'll continue to use them for a lot of what they just said they do, and they really do that.
We truly value our partnership, so thank you for that. So Chris, I believe this is all the time we have today. This has been a lot of fun, thank you. So let me take a moment to thank you for sharing your experience, your stories, your insights on leading digital transformation successfully. It's exciting for me to see how you have gone through this journey, which seemed very difficult at first in the beginning, but very satisfying to see the real business outcomes. And like I said, it's been an honor to continue to partner with you. And also I want to thank our partners at Duck Creek for providing us this platform and everyone joining. Please send us any additional questions or information that you need at the email addresses on the screen, which we'll put it there. You can send it directly to me, sanjay.kanungo@mindtree.com or info@mindtree.com. So Chris, any closing thoughts from you as we wrap up here?
Feel free to reach out to me too. If anybody has any questions, wants to ask any more about our journey, email me, cgriffith@upcinsurance.com. You can find me playing tennis somewhere on a court here locally, so come out and challenge me as well.
Absolutely. Thank you, Chris, and hope to see you soon and do part two of this, maybe in person in a few months, and stay safe and stay healthy, everyone. Thank you.
Bye.